Thanks very much, Samantha, and all the other people who are involved in this invitation. I'm all the happier to be here, given that I remember a rather stormy discussion I had in the auditorium in 2008, right around the time that the Némirovsky exhibit was at the museum. And it was after that discussion where we disagreed violently about how to understand her life and her work, especially her attitude toward Jewishness. I came away thinking, okay, a woman who's been dead for over 60 years, and yet she can get people so riled up and so passionate about how to understand her work, even. How do we read a novel, you know? And I was thinking, anybody who can do that is worth a book. So that's when I first started to do my research on that led to this book. So how many of you actually saw that exhibit, which was called Irène Némirovsky, Woman of Letters? Yeah, in 2008. And so have any of you read Némirovsky? I know some of you have. Okay, fabulous. Now in this book, there are two elements that I want to talk about. There's a story, and so I'll start with the story. And there's an argument that goes with the story, but the story has pictures, so we'll do the fun part first, and then we'll do the argument. So anyway, Némirovsky was born in Kiev, in the city of Kiev, in Ukraine, then part of the Russian Tsarist Empire, in 1903. Into a quite comfortable middle-class Jewish family. There she is, dressed in a little sailor suit around age six. Her father, I say comfortable, her father was actually from a very poor family in Odessa, but he, by virtue of, you know, of a lot of wheeling and dealing, he became quite wealthy and a banker. And her mother came from a somewhat more upwardly striving middle-class family where, for example, they spoke French. The mother's family was extremely proud of the fact that they spoke French, and they looked down somewhat on the father who came from a Yiddish-speaking family. So the kind of tension, you know, that often existed in that period between the more assimilated Jews and the Jews who were associated with poverty and with Yiddish, played itself out to some degree in Némirovsky's own life and her family. And actually, if you only read Suite Française, then you are not aware of this, because there are no Jews in Suite Française. But in a number of her novels, this kind of tension, even within a family, between two kinds of Jews, if you will, is very emphasized, and it's one of the most interesting things, I think, in her work about Jews. Anyway, I just thought I'd show you a picture of Irène with her father, whom she adored, as you can tell, and her relation to her mother was, shall we say, more problematic. If you look at that picture, it's pretty, it sort of speaks volumes, right? You could say, get away from me. And in fact, that's another thing that's a constant in her work is the relations between mothers and daughters. And you know, her work is has quite a few memorably horrible mothers, egotistical, narcissistic, and so forth. Anyway, this family left Russia at the time of the Russian Revolution in 1917, and after, you know, being Finland and Sweden, they ended up in Paris in 1919 when Irène was 16. 10 years later, in 1929, beginning 1930, she became famous, really famous in the French literary world because she published a novel that was then turned into a film. The title of the novel was David Golder, and everybody, it was reviewed everywhere in all the newspapers, and everybody was totally astonished that this very strong, powerful piece of French prose could have been written by a young, feminine woman. That's how the critics sort of eventually came to talk about her. She's just this little petite woman, and she's written an extremely powerful novel, strong, harsh, cruel novel. So this was the sort of way that she was always thought of. But the fact is that after this success, she became, during the 1930s, she went on to write another 10 novels and dozens and dozens of short stories. She became a very rare thing in the French world, in the French literary world of the 1930s. She was a woman who was both commercially successful. She sold, she could make a living. She had a very good publisher who gave her a monthly stipend, and highly respected by the literary establishment. Now that combination of being a woman who could earn her living by her pen, because there were lots of women, journalists and so on, who actually did earn their living by their pen, but they weren't regarded as great novelists. And in fact, Némirovsky was always referred to in the press and by other writers as a grand romancier. Now, if you know French, you know that in the masculine, they, even though she was a woman, they referred to her as un grand romancier, not une grande romancière, because romancière would be like lady writer. So she was never a lady writer. She was considered as a top quality writer in the literary establishment, let's say. And that I just wanted to emphasize because so few people so few women at that time could say that about themselves. Now, in 1926, so before David Golder, she married another Russian Jewish emigre who was quite similar to her in background. She came from a banking family, a very distinguished, actually, banking family. And you can see him here about just a couple of years before he met Irène. This is Michel Epstein. He has sort of a privileged air about him. He's vacationing on one of the lakes in France, Lac d'Annecy. And together they had two daughters. This is a photo of the family in August 1939 in the seaside resort near Biarritz on the Atlantic shore where they always went. And actually this photo has a story to it because you see there are two daughters. One is Denise, pointer isn't working, but the older one, the one on the left, is Denise, who at that point was 10, and her younger sister, Elisabeth, who was 2. And later on, Denise very often said, or she even wrote at one point, that this was the last photo of a happy family, because this was taken in August 1939, just before the outbreak of World War II. Indeed, Némirovsky had created a marvelously successful life, personally and professionally. And this is the personal part, and here, around the same time, in 1938, is a photo of her as author. And you can see, you know, she has the look, you know, of the successful author. Well, unfortunately, all of this was brought to a hideous close by the horrors of World War II. In July of 1942, she was arrested in the small village in Burgundy where the family had taken refuge, taken to a nearby camp and shipped out of there within 2 days. And I just thought I would give you an image of what the bureaucracy of that time was like. Here is the front and back of her registration card in the camp at Pithiviers, which was the camp from where she was deported. And as you can see, the 996 there refers to her barrack number and bed number. But what I really always get sort of totally freaked out by is if you see, again the pointer isn't working, but if you see her name is listed as Epstein, that was her married name, they totally misspell her name. It says Epstein Némirovsky, whatever, it's misspelled. And then on the bottom, where it says profession, they put femme de lettres, woman of letters, okay? That's where that exhibit came from. So they misspell her name, they put her on a wagon, and then they give her this rather formal title, you know, of a woman of letters. And then on the back, there's a rather horrible little notation which says, remis à O, you see A-O, and then the date, which means handed over to the authorities of occupation on 16th of July, 1942. So this was all very carefully kept track of, you know, by the bureaucracy. And I must point out that the bureaucracy was French. In other words, she was handed over to the authorities, and those authorities were German, the actual deportation, the authorities of occupation. But the people who rounded her up and put her there and kept track of her and gave her cards were French police. So 3 months later, her husband Michel was also arrested and deported and died in Auschwitz. She died in Auschwitz in August, 1 month after she was deported. She was 39 years old. So now the daughters, however, Denise and Elisabeth survived. They survived with the help of a woman who worked for the family, who hid them. She took them away from that village to near where she lived in Bordeaux on the Atlantic shore coast. And here I just thought I'd show you two pictures of the girls. One on the left is the one of them around 1938. You can see Elisabeth is 1 year old. Her sister is beautifully combed, has a gorgeous little girl dress. They look like girls of, you know, which they were, of an upper middle class, you know, French Parisian family. And then on the right, you see them with their sort of bedraggled coats in 1943, when Denise was 14, almost 14, and her sister was born in 37, so her sister was six. Now the two girls, I tell that whole story in the book of how they survived the war and also what happened to them afterwards. But let's just say that the story is that their mother was forgotten almost immediately after the war for a very long time. And that's really where my book begins because, of course, as you all know, in 2004, she came spectacularly back to life with the publication of this novel, Suite Française, which was written in the last year and a half of her life. She was still working on it when she was arrested, and which took Paris by storm, and not only Paris, but the world. This book won a major book award, and a literary award, and then went on to sell a very impressive number of copies, hundreds of thousands of copies in France, and then became an international bestseller. This novel, which takes place in France during the first year of German occupation, is, in my opinion, a really brilliant work. And I must say that I became interested in Némirovsky only after reading this novel, even though I knew about her before. And I just thought the thing about this book that really got to me when I read it is it's being written more or less, you know, as the events are unfolding. She's writing in 1941 about June 1940, about the arrival of the Germans in Paris and the French people who leave Paris in a panic and head south. And then about a village which is occupied in the fall of 1940. So she's writing about her present. It's really a history of the present. But her perspective and her point of view is that of a historical novelist. That is, she somehow achieves a tone and a way of looking, which is really distant. You know, Tolstoy was her big model. She kept writing about Tolstoy in her journal, and she and War and Peace, obviously. But Tolstoy wrote War and Peace 50 years after the events that he's writing about, whereas Némirovsky wrote Suite Française, you know, 3 weeks after the events that she's writing about. And yet she has that kind of detachment that only comes from distance. And my way of reading this, my way of understanding this, is that she's writing as a Jew. In other words, her point of view is that of an outsider. She can look at the people around her with very often with a great deal of irony because of the way they respond to the occupation. Most of them are not great. As you, those of you who've read it, you know that she doesn't have too much sympathy for most of the French middle class, especially. And the way they responded to the Nazis, first panic and then, okay, we can live with them. Her way of looking at them is, I think, influenced by the fact that she feels herself to be so excluded at this point. I mean, she is such an outsider. Some people have said, well, why aren't there any Jews in Suite Française? My response to that is, there is a Jew. It's the narrator. The narrator is the Jew in this novel. We can say a lot more about this book, but to go on with the story, the really beautiful thing about the story, of course, as you all know, it was published by Némirovsky's older daughter, actually, in 2004. And so you could, in a way, we could say that Denise brought her mother back to life by this act of publication. And I should point out, though, that already 10 years earlier, her younger sister, Elisabeth, there's Suite Française, just had a cover of her younger sister Elisabeth. This is the author photo of Elisabeth in 1992. You can see she looks like a Parisian intellectual, which she was. She became a very successful editor and translator in Paris. But she actually, in 1992, she published a book about her mother. And that book was the first time that Némirovsky's name began finally to be talked about in France, although it kind of died down quickly. But what happened to Elisabeth as a result of that book is that she became a writer. She had always been an editor and translator and loved and admired writers greatly, but she never wrote. And after she wrote the book about her mother, she wrote two others, one of which is a beautiful novel. And unfortunately died of lung cancer in 1996. But you could see that in a way, both of these daughters, and that's the part that I emphasize in the book, both of these daughters participated in bringing their mother back to life. And she in turn gave them a kind of a new life. Because Elisabeth became a writer and Denise became rich, which not only, to some extent rich. She had been poor all her life. Denise had a very different life from her sister, and she had really not had money. And suddenly she could afford a nice apartment, you know? And not only that, but she became famous in her own right. Because people invited her everywhere, again, all over the world. She was here at the museum in 2008 for the opening. She was invited as the daughter, the surviving daughter of this writer who could talk about her mother. So Denise's life was totally transformed in the last 9 years of her life. And that's why, you know, I call the chapter where I talk about this gifts of life, because they're kind of reciprocal gifts, right? The girls bring the mother back, and the mother gives them a whole new life. So that's really the fun part, shall we say, of my book. I had a great deal of fun also tracking down the family. You know, I met Denise several times. Oh, here, by the way, the village where Némirovsky lived, was arrested. The place where she lived has now been named Place Irène Némirovsky, and they put Prix Renaudot, that was the literary prize. And this is the place itself. It's where the war monument is. And the house behind the war monument, that door, is where Némirovsky lived and was arrested. And there's a plaque on that door as well. So in a way, she has become the celebrity of the village. These are photos I took in 2014. And then here is one of my, this is the last picture. This is Denise in the middle with her daughter Irène and her granddaughter Juliette in Toulouse, in the city of Toulouse in 2011. Denise died in 2013. So, you know, tracing these generations, because I ended up interviewing all the grandchildren and great-grandchildren of Némirovsky, and asking them what this, what her, the she and Jewishness actually meant to them. That was the fun part. Now, the other part is, it's also fun, but it's a slightly more thorny thing because there's a twist to the story. After the publication of Suite Française, the publisher, her publisher, reissued all of her previous work, including several novels that featured Jewish main characters, one of them being David Golder, the thing that made her famous. And when some contemporary critics read these books, the ones that featured Jewish characters, they said, oh my God, she was a Jewish anti-Semite. These are stereotypes. We are outraged. These are horrible portrayals of Jews. And so overnight, practically, she went from being a victim, you know, to be pitied, to a kind of a hateful figure to be condemned, the self-hating Jew or the Jewish anti-Semite. That's what we were arguing about when I was here. So I just thought that that was a too simplistic a way of looking at things. And I decided that really I had to write about this writer and her work in a way that would complicate the image somewhat, or quite a bit. I mean, the people who blamed her had things to blame her for. For example, one of the things is she published stories in a newspaper that started out as a kind of a liberal paper, a weekly, but became more and more anti-Semitic. And she never stopped publishing there. And she converted to Catholicism in February 1939. So people who want to blame her can find reasons to blame her. But what I wanted to do, actually, was two things. First of all, with her life, I wanted to situate her life in a broader context and to really talk about the choices that she made, you know? Even the choice to marry a man just like herself, that meant that she wasn't going to be French, which is very interesting for somebody who wants to be a French writer. Why couldn't she find a French man to marry? Many, many other Jewish women, young Jewish women in France at the time, found nice French Catholic boys to marry. What does she do? She marries Michel Epstein, who is, just like her. He has no passport, he's a foreign Jew, and she was deported as a foreign Jew, so as was he. Things like that, but also her decision, many, many other choices that she made, her decision to publish in that newspaper, which actually was highly regarded for its literary pages, and many people read it, but still, it became very anti-Semitic. So I was trying to understand the choices that she made and what were the other possibilities that other people chose without condemning, I mean, you know, without judging her, because I don't feel that it is up to me or anyone today to sit in judgment over the choices that people made in the past. And the people who chose what they chose couldn't foresee what the consequences of their choices would be. So we have to allow for the fact that they simply made the choice hoping for the best, the way we all make choices. And that is the challenge that I sort of tried to meet in the book about her life. And then the other thing that I tried to do was to show how it was possible to read her work in a way, her work about Jews, in a way that, again, would allow for, you know, a less sort of bludgeoning somebody, oh, you're a self-hating Jew, goodbye. But really to understand what she was writing about. And what I finally came up with is that what she is really writing about is what I call the Jewish question for Jews. And the big Jewish question for Jews, in Europe, but not only in Europe, but especially in the interwar period was, are we ever going to be accepted by the national non-Jewish majority? This had been the question for Jews since the 19th century. In other words, it's really the question of assimilation. Is assimilation possible if I want to assimilate, if I want to be accepted as a German or as a Frenchman or as a Hungarian, will I ever be? And what she actually does is deal with that question in what I think is an extremely interesting and subtle and rather terrifyingly pessimistic way. Because she doesn't think, the answer to the question for her is no. Jews will never be completely accepted. This causes a tremendous amount of unease. Why? Well, actually, their existential unease is even more complicated than that, because what she shows is they're not going to be accepted for at least two reasons, internal and external. The internal reason is that they are totally anxious, not able to really fit in. Why? Because there's a whole history of persecution of Jews. So she had this view, in a way, almost a racial inheritance. You know, Jews are by definition born into anxiety. That they're born into anxiety psychologically, partly because of that whole long tradition of persecution. So they will never feel quite at ease in their environment or in their skin. But the other reason is, and she has very interesting touches of that in her novels and in her short stories. The other reason, of course, is external. Jews are uneasy because the people around them are anti-Semitic. At least, you know, if you scratch them, they will be anti-Semitic. Even in France, which was the sort of haven for Jews for a long time, you know, there was a thought that France was a paradise for Jews because it was a country of emancipation. Especially as the 1930s wore on, and more xenophobia, more and more anti-foreign discourse, more and more anti-Jewish discourse was obvious. Némirovsky, I think, became really very negative, very pessimistic in her view. One of her last books, the last book she wrote about Jews, is called The Dogs and the Wolves, and it's really a fascinating book about a family of Russian Jews. She always goes back to the Russian Jews who arrive in France, and then the two branches. One is the rich branch, the poor branch. But she does almost a sociological study of this family, and it's just, in my opinion, it's a really brilliant novel. And then she gave up writing about Jews. This was published in 1940, just around the time that the Germans entered France. So, I mean, I hope I make a compelling argument in my book for why we should read her this way, rather why we should read her as the chronicler of Jewish anxiety. It's not only then and not only in Europe that Jews have a certain anxiety, right, about anti-Semitism. So, and who ask themselves these questions, do I belong, am I accepted? I think we're seeing some of that everywhere. I hope I make a compelling argument, but I'm also aware that, there are people who just won't read her books that way. And already back in the 30s, there were people who didn't read her books that way. In other words, like when David Golder was published, as I told you, every major newspaper reviewed it and loved it. And they didn't talk about the fact that it wasn't the fact that he was a Jew that mattered. What David Golder is a Jewish poor guy, like Némirovsky's father, a poor man who rises to the top and is unhappy because his wife is terrible. He's not a happy man. But we know such books. You know, they've been written here too. What Makes Sammy Run, many, many other books about Jews who rise to the top and yet are unhappy, or non-Jews who rise to the top and are unhappy. But anyway, now David Golder, at the time it was published, there were some Jews who were upset. And they said, why are you writing such a negative book about Jews? And they sent the official Jewish journal of the French community sent a journalist twice to interview her. And, you know, they said, why can't you write a nicer, happier book about Jews? And she said, this is how I saw them. You know, which is her freedom as a writer to write what she sees, right? I just want to make this point that I'm aware that my way of reading is not the only way. And in fact, if somebody is convinced that this book is anti-Semitic, for example, it's very hard to dislodge that conviction. But I have one little trump card, if I can use that word, which is, and that's the last thing I think I'll say, because I'm sure there are questions and so on, which is to compare her, one of the ways to be persuasive is to compare her books about Jews to the books of real anti-Semites. And there you understand the difference, because in the novel by what I call the real anti-Semite, even if they're genteel anti-Semites, not vicious ones, what is set up, what you get is a dichotomy, us versus them. The Jews are always represented as different from us, us being the French in this case. So you have this us versus them, where we are, the novelist is sort of on the we side, and then there's them. In the case of Némirovsky, it's never that way. It's always us versus us, that is, we Jews, poor Jews against rich Jews, Jews, you know, against themselves, whatever, but never, I mean, and she even turns the table, because it's wonderful, in one of her novels, she has the Jewish Russian émigré woman think of her French neighbors as the foreigners. You know, in other words, instead of being the foreigners, from her point of view, it's they who are the foreigners, right? So that's why I call that a trump card, because if you really compare what she writes about Jews to what a genuine, you know, French anti-Semite writes, there is absolutely no comparison in my opinion. I mean, I think it's pretty clear, actually. So anyway, that's what I did, and I hope that you will have questions. Thank you. Good, we're doing fine. Okay, yes.
You wrote about a book, I read your book already, but you wrote about a book called Fraternity that I thought was really interesting.
It's a short story, yes, thank you for bringing that up. It's my perfect exhibit A. She wrote a short story called Fraternité, Fraternity or Brotherhood, which was published in 1937, already a bad time, actually, for foreigners and Jews in France. And it's just, it's almost like a Jewish joke, but it's absolutely wonderful. It's by Jewish joke, I mean two Jews meet on a train platform. You know, many Jews jokes begin that way, and so do the stories of Sholem Aleichem, actually, two Jews meet in a train. So one is a rich, assimilated Jew, and his name is Christian Rabinovich, okay? Now, you know, if you want to talk about conflicted identities, Christian Rabinovich meets he's rich, he's, you know, comfortable. His car broke down, that's why he's on this train platform. Well, he meets this poor Jew, you know, who looks feverish, and he has this little boy in his arm, turns out to be his grandson. And he really looks like the poor Jew. And it turns out that his name is also Rabinovich. And so the poor Jew asks Christian, so when did you come here? And Christian says, I was born here, and so was my father. And the poor one says, well, then it must have been your grandfather, because only the poor Jews left back there. They were looking for a better world. And so in the space of a few pages, she manages, you know, exactly, because Rabinovich Christian says, oh, I have nothing to do with this man. I have nothing to do with this man. This is absurd to think that I have anything to do with this man, even though he has my name. And then he begins to shake, to go back and forth with the train, just like the rabbinical grandfathers. So, you know, it's a perfect example of what I was talking about, the sort of the combination of inner and external factors. I mean, Christian Rabinovich, even though he has been here for generations, still has, and she writes about that in her journal, he has that sickening fear, she said, that sickening fear in heritage. She writes that in English, sickening fear. So, yeah, thank you for bringing that up. Yes.
So I have a question. I know she converted to Catholicism, so the idea that she was deported because of her husband's ex-Jewish name, or maybe they knew she was Jewish. And the other question in conjunction is, did her offspring, her children, her grandchildren, did they go back to Judaism, or what was their name?
Wonderful question, thank you.
Repeat it.
So, what was
repeat the question, they didn't hear the question.
Oh, they didn't hear the question, okay. Two questions, what was your first question again?
The first question was she was deported based on...
Oh, right, if she converted, why was she deported as a Jew? And second question, did her daughters and her descendants, did they come back in a way to Judaism? Yes, she did convert, but as you know, the Germans and Vichy France also, I have to say, had what is called racial anti-Semitism. That is, for them, it wasn't a matter of religion. Judaism was not a religion, it was a race. And so no matter what you did, you could convert 8,000 times, you were still a Jew. So if you have three grandparents who were Jewish, okay? So one of the first things that the Germans did when they occupied France is they published a decree that every Jew in the occupied version and then soon in the whole country had to go and register in the police station. And the Germans, because it was their decree, but it was also the Vichy government totally cooperated in this with the French police. That so you had these cards. People, once they went to register, that was it. They became targets. So people, and the odd thing is that something like 85 or 90% of the Jewish population in France, or in the eventually all of France, went and registered as Jews. In other words, they were shocked. They were horrified. What is this? Liberty, equality, fraternity, and they're making us go and register? And by the way, you remember that there was some talk about making Muslims in the US register? So they went and registered, and that was signing a death warrant practically, because they could be, at that point, they were tracked, and when there were roundups, if there was a roundup, the police knew where they were. Now, eventually, people became, you know, smarter and tried to hide and everything, but that first shock of October 1940. Was terrible. And so Némirovsky and her husband went and registered in their little village in Burgundy. They always wanted to be in the, you know, legal. They respected the law. So she was deported as a foreign Jew. She and her husband both had that label, if you will. They had no passport. They were foreigners from Russia, and they were Jews in the eyes of Vichy and in the eyes of the Germans. So it's very interesting, and I'm sorry that I can't go into all the details here because of I do in the book. It's very interesting how the two daughters came around to a very real, although somewhat tenuous, Jewish identity, because it's true they spent a number of years in a Catholic boarding school, especially the younger one, Elizabeth, who was very young at the end of the war. She spent like 10 years in it. And for a long time, and she was the one that I think I identified to some degree more, although I knew her older sister quite well, because she became a writer and so on. But Elizabeth, for a number of years, did not think of herself as a Jew. She wasn't a Catholic either, she was an atheist. But a Jew is what other people call a Jew. That's what Jean-Paul Sartre said in a famous book, and that's how she felt. And then in the 1970s, she began to really get very interested. She joined a sort of secular Jewish group with other Parisian intellectuals. And I should just point out that this kind of personal evolution which happened for her in the mid-1970s, also is what happened to the French community the Jews in France in general. Why? Because right after the war, very few Jews wanted to talk about being Jewish. Many changed their names, you know, they were traumatized. And it was only in the 70s that you had the beginning of a kind of outpouring of Jewish memoirs about what happened to people during the war, and also, you know, just in general, a kind of, acclaim to Jewish identity that was not made right in the years right after the war. So Elizabeth's evolution is like that of, you know, many, many other Jews. Her sister took even longer, actually, I discovered, because she was very traumatized. She was older. She was, you know, 7 years older than Elizabeth. And she was severely traumatized by what happened during the war, having to hide, you know. The woman who hid them when they were out in public, occasionally she would say to Denise, hide your nose, because it could. So then she told me, she said, you know, for many years, my first gesture when I met somebody new was to put my hand up to my nose. She said, this is absurd, but, you know, this is how she was marked by this. So Denise actually, for a number of years, she had her children baptized. She was taking no chances. She was married in a church to a Catholic. They're both married French Catholics, actually. But Elizabeth, atheist intellectual, and her husband too, but Denise, no. So they went to church. But eventually, Denise also came around. And of course, in her last 15 years or so, she went around to schools talking about, you know, her experiences during the war. And so she identified with what she called, you know, the secular Jews, basically. I didn't put in one last photo, which I have in the book, actually, which is quite moving. Both sisters, they're buried together in a grave with their grandparents, actually, Némirovsky's parents, in Paris, in a cemetery, in a sort of a slight, somewhat Jewish section. I mean, it's not a very separate, but the grave is Jewish, and you can see they also put the names of Irene and her husband dead in Auschwitz, and you can see little pebbles, you know, in other words, people who go leave pebbles. So they are buried, they were buried, and they had a rabbi officiate at their funeral, both of them. So I think that's a sign. Now, if you ask me about their descendants, I think their descendants are almost all, her descendants are almost all, grandchildren and great-grandchildren are almost all totally non-religious, or sometimes outspokenly, you know, anti-religious. And they don't feel particularly Jewish, except one of them told me, in one kind of occasion, when she hears people making anti-Semitic remarks, then she says, yes, you know, I'm a Jew, so, you know, stop talking like that. That's the answer to your question. Yes, Leah.
I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about the conversion. Why that conversion? I mean, there's one particular response to exclusion to try to convert. There are other, obviously, a whole range of possible responses, and one of them that you could think about would be Zionism, some political response. Was there any kind of political evidence in her life that she was sympathetic to this Zionism or to some other kind of escape from Europe?
Two questions, really. One is, why did she convert, or what were her motives for converting, really? And the second question, was she at all sympathetic to Zionism? Or, in other words, if you didn't believe in assimilation, you could become a Zionist. That's absolutely true. Herzl founded, supposedly, you know, decided that the Jews could no longer stay in Europe when he saw Captain Dreyfus being you know, the sword broken in the courtyard of the military academy in Paris in 1895. So he saw this and he said, now I understand, Jews have no future in Europe. So two questions. Well, the conversion is very interesting because if you asked Denise in the late year, in the last years of her life, she would give the very simple answer, which is, Irene was trying to protect the family, and she thought that by converting, that would protect them, which of course turned out to be totally false. She was, this is not entirely right. She began to, you know, actively seek conversion in late 1938, had a very quick conversion, and kept telling the prelate who converted her that she couldn't go and see him, although she had promised to, because she had the mumps, she had a cold, she had, you know, there were a lot of reasons why she couldn't make the appointment, so she didn't get too much of a catechistic education. But I think, I mean, if you read what she writes in her journals at the time, one of the things, she's genuine. She's reading the Gospels, she's reading the New Testament, and making remarks about Jesus. You know, at one point, for example, she writes, Jesus was a God, that is to say, a man like us. Which is a rather strange thing to say. I mean, not kosher theologically, I would say. But I think that her main motivation personally was a desire for security. In other words, at one point she just says, "If only I could feel secure." She was a very, very troubled soul. I mean, you get that if you read. Journals. She often had what she called, you know, her black days, her black periods. She was, you know, where she just would have a terrible depression and then come out of it miraculously. But I think there was this sickening fear that she talks about, you know, with Christian Rabinovich was also in herself. She knew what she was talking about. And I think for her, Catholicism represented the possibility of finding peace and finding inner security and inner peace. And also, I mean, in a way, you could say, if she wanted to be French, you know, French at that time especially were Catholics, I mean, you know. But I think it was less important than this deep desire to find some kind of inner sense of security. It wasn't just an expedient thing. It was really something deeper, I think, in her that she was looking for.
What about Zionism?
Oh, Zionism. Yes, thank you. Look, she always kept saying, you know, I'm not a political writer. She did have a kind of a politics. She was very anti-communist. She wrote a couple of things. I mean, you know, she was a young girl in the revolution, and she saw some of the fighting and so on. I mean, you know, she was not a left-winger, let's put it that way. But she was not at all politically active, you know? And I have not seen any sign, really, in her, you know, notebooks or anything. She didn't write about Zionism. She was really very, very focused on Jews in France. For example, one of the people who really fascinated her was Léon Blum. You know, the French prime minister, he was prime minister in 1936, and people hated him. The anti-Semites were outraged that a Jew could become prime minister of France. Léon Blum was a wonderful man, a real intellectual, fine human being, etc. But he was attacked on the street, practically killed, you know, while he was at one point. So there was, you know, but she was fascinated by him. For some reason, I mean, you know, she was this French Jewish, you know, established French Jew who became prime minister. But even he, you know, there must be some contradiction and conflict in him. So she just wasn't, you know, she wasn't thinking in terms of Zionism, as far as I can tell. Yes, I think yes.
During Némirovsky's time, on the political side, you had pretty extreme anti-Semitic
Sir, excuse me, can you speak a bit louder?
I'll try.
She can hear you.
Politically, you had pretty extreme anti-Jewish thinking with the French right, Mabas, and literature, you had virulent anti-Semitism.
Absolutely.
Sedin and whatnot. How popular, how widely followed were the two sides in France as a whole?
How popular were these writers?
Both, if you took the political bent and the artistic bent, the right, the literature, I mean, were they pretty heavily endorsed?
I hate to say this, but Céline's so-called pamphlet, which was called Bagatelle pour un massacre, which came out in 1937, was a bestseller. I mean, it was a very, very, very crazily anti-Semitic book. Céline was the most sort of, he's a problem writer for France because he was a brilliant, brilliant stylist. And his first book, Voyage to the End of Night, was not overtly, or it's a very hard, I have not found any signs of anti-Semitism in it, and I teach it, and it's an absolutely brilliant book, a very important book in French literature. So he was, you know, he's a real problem for people because, okay, it's kind of like Ezra Pound to some degree, you know, Ezra Pound, a brilliant poet, but a totally nutcase anti-Semite. And so was Céline, actually, a nutcase anti-Semite. People, some of them, they didn't take him seriously. They said, this can't be real. But in fact, it was. He was a sort of pathological anti-Semite. Now, there were others, though, who were much more sane, you know, and who wrote vicious, vicious books, like one very established writer named Paul Morand, who wrote a kind of a satire on Jews in the film business, which they're going to take over the business, you know, like, but it was terrible. This man was a member of he wasn't yet a member of the French Academy, but he was very well connected. And alas, he wasn't a friend of Némirovsky. But Némirovsky respected him, partly because he had also published many books in the 20s, which were regarded as cosmopolitan travels, etc. So he wasn't regarded at the time as a vicious anti-Semite. But this one book, published in 1935, about the Jews in the film industry, was horrible. And even some French writers, I talk about one, who was considered a philo-Semite. When you read his book now, you see, oh my God, you know, it's perfect, but the perfect thing of Us Versus Them, the book that he wrote, which was considered philo-Semitic, is just horrible to read now, because he's really setting up the Us Versus Them, you know. So, but yet that man, Jacques de La Clotel, was highly regarded, including by a number of Jewish readers. So that's the answer to your question about how popular they were. They were pretty popular. As far as the right, politically, the right had a strong movement in the 30s. I mean, there was practically a takeover in February 1934. You know, there were clashes between right-wing groups. There was a sort of a homegrown fascist movement in France in the mid-30s. It never got that far, but in 37, 38, there was a party formed, the French Populist Party. What's happening now really harkens back to the 30s, alas, but you know, it had a leader who was a charismatic leader, and that party lasted right through the war. The PPF, Parti Populaire Français, the French Populist Party, really, is how it translates. So, you know, yes, I mean, there were many people who did espouse and listen to right-wing anti-Semitic discourse, and anti-foreigner discourse as well. There was one other person who had their hand up. If you don't mind, I'll do that. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
How important was it having Russian identity later on in my life? Do you think you have got something that you should say or
Well, it's very interesting, the Russian identity. She, you know, in her journals, sometimes she will write in French. She will occasionally have an English word, and also occasionally a Russian word. Like, you know, when she tries to explain something, it's like that, and she will write it in Russian. So I had to have some of those translated. So I think she was still very, you know, much connected in a way to the language. And one of the things she wrote in the last 2 years of her life, she was writing like a crazy person during the war. She wrote three novels, I don't know, a dozen short stories, and Suite Française, and a biography of Chekhov. And the biography of Chekhov was her husband, Michel, who actually probably had an even stronger command of Russian language than she did. She left, he was older than she was, and when he left, he was slightly older. She left Russia when she was 14. He left when he was in his early 20s or 20. And so she had him do research for her on the Chekhov biography. But her daughter Denise told me that her closest friends were Russians, Russian Jews, actually. And I believe that. I mean, I know of at least two individuals with whom she was very close. And Michel's two brothers and a sister in Paris. And they were the people whom they really frequented, you know, on a regular basis. She would go into society, I guess, but her, you know, the people she felt comfortable with were in fact Russian emigres like herself. Or somewhat similar to herself. Oh, and now you had a question.
Yes, you mentioned in your book Jeff Goldberg's article in The Atlantic, is it time for the Jews to leave Europe? I just want to know your comment on
that. Where are they going to go? Come to the States? Right now? Canada. Israel. Well, you know, Netanyahu is inviting Jews to go to Israel. I think Jeff Goldberg's article was a little too scaremongering, really. I mean, I have a lot of Jewish friends in France who are more, you know, they're secular Jews. They don't walk around with a kippah or any kind of visible identifying marker, because the people who are the targets of hate crimes or of anti-Semitic actions are in fact the people who are more, you know, identified with their kids are in Jewish schools, they walk around with a kippah in public. I mean, you know, a couple of summers ago, somebody in a man who was, I think it was in Marseille, was walking around with a kippah, it was attacked. And one of the rabbis in France at that point said, well, maybe you shouldn't walk around with a kippah, which is a terrible thing to have to say, you know. But at any rate, but the more secular Jews, many of them are extremely well-placed in French society. I mean, they're professors, they're journalists, they're writers, they're doctors, lawyers, whatever, and they are not about to leave. I mean, they're certainly not planning to leave, not yet. But still, at the same time, those very people who are so highly regarded, you know, and inserted into society, have told me that it's a shock, you know, when there are certain public parades, demonstrations, anti-Israel demonstrations, which then morph into death to the Jews. One said, this is incredible. A couple of years ago, there was such a demonstration in Paris. She said, I couldn't believe that I was hearing again this slogan, death to the Jews, which of course had been, you know, a slogan of the 30s and 40s. So. I think everything, and if Marine Le Pen gets, heaven help us, if she gets elected, which is not out of the question. Marine Le Pen, you know, who is the leader of the National Front, and she's trying, you know, one of the biggest ironies, which kills me, is that Marine Le Pen has a number of Jewish supporters, quite a few. You know why? Because they think she hates the Arabs. She hates the Muslims. This is what we've come to. I mean, when Jews support Marine Le Pen, I just give up. But she has tried to tone down her any kind of anti-Semitic association. Her father was clearly anti-Semitic. He founded the party, and he didn't make any bones about it. But she, you know, wants to be nice to Jews.